Good morning and greetings to all of you. It's so lovely to be in the Lord's presence. I think church is the better place to be in. The people worshiping Christ, longing to hear the word of God and fellowshipping. Where else you want to be? But for some people, coming to church is a routine, right? They don't want to come and sit and listen to. So there was a boy, small boy, he told his mom, "Mom, when I grow big, I want to become a pastor." The mother heard this, she was very happy. And she told her son, "Oh honey, that's so sweet of hearing you. Tell me, why do you want to become a pastor?" And the son said, "Well, it's pretty clear that I should go to church every Sunday. It's a lot of fun to stand and scold people than sitting and listening." Well, I'm not here to scold you today, but I'm here to share with you the supremacy of God in our lives. John Johnson, in his book, The Glory of Preaching, he says, when we share God's word, we participate in the salvific act of the triune God. Let me add, it is not just by sharing God's word. While listening God's word, while processing God's word, we do participate in the act of the triune God. Hallelujah. So it's good to be in the presence of God and be happy that you are listening and I'm sharing. We all participate in the mission of God. And for that, we need God's wisdom to understand God's word. So would you pause for a moment and pray with me? Lord God, we marvel at your grand design, the design of your creation, the design of our very lives. Everything in line with your covenantal relationship for the restorative mission for your creation. Lord, we thank you for your word. The word is so refreshing, so timely. It speaks to all generations, to all people. We pray, Lord, that you would speak to us. We hear and listen and obey. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I wish somebody could read the text, the biblical text that we have today. Can I ask Jian, would you like to come forward and read the text, Genesis 29, verses 15 through 30.
I'm reading from ESV. Verse 15. Then Laban said to Jacob, "Because you are my kinsman, should you therefore serve me for nothing? Tell me, what shall your wages be?" Now Laban had two daughters. The name of the older was Leah, and the name of the younger was Rachel. Leah's eyes were weak, but Rachel was beautiful in form and appearance. Jacob loved Rachel. And he said, "I will serve you 7 years for your younger daughter, Rachel." Verse 19, Laban said, "It is better that I give her to you than that I should give her to any other man. Stay with me." So Jacob served 7 years for Rachel, and they seemed to him but a few days before because of the love he had for her. Verse 21, then Jacob said to Laban, "Give me my wife that I may go in to her, for my time is completed." So Laban gathered together all the people of the place and made a feast. But in the evening he took his daughter Leah and brought her to Jacob, and he went into her. Verse 28, Laban gave his female servant Zilpah to his daughter Leah to her servant. Verse 25, and in the morning, behold, it was Leah. And Jacob said to Laban, "What is this you have done to me? Did I not serve with you for Rachel? Then why then have you deceived me?" Laban said, "It is not so done in our country to give the younger before the firstborn. Complete the week of this one, and we will give you the other also in return for serving me another 7 years." Jacob did so and completed her week. Then Laban gave him his daughter Rachel to be his wife. Verse 29, Laban gave his female servant Bilhah to his daughter Rachel to be her servant. So Jacob went into Rachel also, and he loved Rachel more than Leah, and served Laban for another 7 years. May God bless each one of us.
Thank you for reading the word, Jian. The deceiver deceived, but the divine directive prevails. And this is a beautiful story, isn't it? It's a beautiful story about Joseph. Did I say Joseph? So whenever I say Joseph, I mean Jacob. Is that okay? It is about Jacob marrying Leah and Rachel. And we wonder what this story has to say to us. There is one thing that is common in this story. It is all about people. There are people. Uncle Laban is there, and our Jacob, the naughty and deceiver, is there. And we have Rachel and Leah, the men of that place, gathering and drinking, full of people. What they have to do for us. You see, God's truth is not to be found in vacuum. It's not to be found in abstract way. It involves people. It involves real lives. If you want to know God, know your people, know your society. God works in and through people. And the another thing I wanted to say from this text is such a beautiful story. I keep telling the word of God is both beautiful in form, and if you could read the story in Hebrew, if you can, it is such a beautiful. And every dialogue is so beautiful, rhyming. And not only that, it is a story that has both good and bad. It's a plain story. It's about Jacob, what he does and what he shouldn't do. Laban, what he shouldn't do. This story is important because this story is part of God's grand story. Every story counts. You might think your story is insignificant. You don't have a spectacular story to say. But know that every story is part of the grand narratives of God's mission. Every story counts. As we journey together through this narrative, I want to talk about three important lessons that are foundational for our Christian living. The first thing is about the choices we make. The choices we make matters. The second thing is about the things that we do. Everything that we do matters. And lastly, in the midst of all the choices and all the actions, God's direction, God's purpose would prevail. First, every choice you make matters. John C. Maxwell says, life is a matter of choices. And every choice you make makes you. You see, when Laban makes that generous offer, in verse 15, Laban tells Jacob, are you not my brother? Should you work for me nothing? Now tell me, what is your wages? And you come to verse 18, the second part. Now, Jacob makes good use of the opportunity and he says, I will work for you 7 years in exchange of Rachel. That will be my bride price to you. I will work for you 7 years and you will get Rachel married to me, your younger daughter. And right between the dialogue, there is some background information. Verses 16 and 17. And we are told, Laban had two daughters. The name of the elder one is Leah, and the name of the younger one is Rachel. Now, verse 17, you guys, you might like it. Verse 17 says, the eyes of Leah were tender, but Rachel was beautiful in shape and beautiful in appearance. Now, scholars debate, what does it mean, Leah's eyes were tender and soft? Some say Leah's eyes were soft, tender, attractive. Some say Leah's eyes were weak. I would say that actually it's not about the eyes of Leah. It's actually about her bodily physical features, because the word ayin can mean spring or fountain. It can probably refer to the bodily features of Leah. Well, the point is, Rachel was beautiful in shape and beautiful in appearance. And obviously, Jacob loves Rachel. And we wonder why Jacob loves Rachel. Leah was equally beautiful. Her eyes were tender, beautiful girl, but Jacob loved Rachel. He found Rachel beautiful. You know, in the ancient Near Eastern setting, beauty is not about the color. It's about ability, virtues, and loyalty. Women in those days, they used to come out. They tended the flocks. They watered the flocks. They received the guests. They did all sorts of household chores. And more likely, their skin got burnt. It is not about color, how soft, how tender, how slim. That was not the beauty. Beauty is about the virtuous woman. And Jacob chose the woman he liked, he found virtuous, able, loyal, and he loved her. Jacob made, I think, his choice. He was willing to work for 7 years. My goodness, 7 years to reach the love of his life. He found Rachel so valuable that he was willing to work for her 7 years and marry her. He was willing to sacrifice the prime of his life and get his love of his life. You know, it is often said beauty is subjective. It is in the eyes of the beholder. In Southeast Asia, beauty is all about being slim and being beautiful, being soft, being girly. In South Korea, almost 80% of women go through some kind of cosmetic surgery. And even men, they go through some kind of surgery. In the Philippines, where we spend some time, women used to carry their makeup items in their pocket all the time. And almost every 1 hour, they would go to the toilet and do makeup and come out. Married women, they fear if they don't look beautiful, their husbands would leave them off. They are very beauty conscious. Now, don't get me wrong. Being beautiful is good. Spouses, please look beautiful before your husbands. And husbands, be smart before your wives. Beautiful is good. And I don't agree with the pastors who marry just for their ministry's sake. No, you should live and love your wives. You don't compromise your marriage for your ministry's sake. You should love. Beautiful, being beautiful is good. Being smart is good. But know that it's not about color. It's not about being slim. It's not about being soft. It's about being a woman of virtues. It's about a man of values. It's about being loyal to the Lord. It's about being active in the mission of God. And I found Margaret, where are you? Okay, I found Margaret beautiful, able, and committed to mission. And I think I made a good choice. And poor girl, she had to marry me. And I did all the best to get her because I was afraid, what if somebody proposes her and take her away? I find this saying, one of the Christian leaders that I admire, he says this: the books you read, the people you meet, and the decisions you make are going to define you in the next 10 years. The choices that you make is very crucial. Young people, I want you to be aware that often it is the mainline media that tells us what is beauty. It tells us what is fashion. To me, that is a minority voice. No. But they echo so much. We are so much influenced by what beauty is, what is fashion. And that is unfortunate. Watch out. Your life choices and commitment should not be deterred by models and media. Don't look for wheat color, but look for the woman of virtues. Look for the man of values. You say God looks at the person. Humans, they look at outward external features, but God looks the inner art. As God's people, we value person as they are. We make choices carefully. We value virtue, conduct, and character. We don't judge people because of their color, creed, and caste. We are committed to each other. We are committed to our families. We sacrificially build and edify each other. Husbands, you are living with the love of your life. Love your wives. Wives, God has brought you the person who valued more than anybody else. Children, know that your parents love each other. They might fight and argue, but they love each other. And they made choice for your existence. I'm going to tell you one more thing. God finds each one of us the most handsome and the most beautiful. Can you imagine? You are the most beautiful person in God's sight, most handsome person in God's eyes. I usually don't say hallelujah, but I'm propelled to say hallelujah. What do you think? Hallelujah. It's a Hebrew word saying praise be to God because we are so precious in God's sight. Make your choices count. Watch out your choices. Every choice that you make in your life counts. Not only the choice that you make, even the things that you do in life, it matters. Everything that you do has its consequences. Now, Jacob is on the receiving end. Uncle Laban is too good to Jacob. He's so good to deceive Jacob. You see, verse 19, Laban says, "It is good for me to give my daughter to you than giving her to other man. Stay with me." And Jacob worked for Rachel 7 years. And all those days looked like a very few days because he loved her. And after that, Jacob said to Laban, "Bring my woman, bring my wife, because my days are completed, my days are full, my service is over, so that I will spend the rest of my life with her." So Laban makes, he brings all the men of the place and he makes a great feasting. Actually, it's a marriage feasting. In ancient Near Eastern setting, the marriage takes place from 4 to 6 days. In the evening, the father would bring the girl covered by veil, assisted by a maid, would bring the girl to the groom, and the groom would cover her with another veil and take her to the house, and they will consummate. So Laban brings his daughter, but not Rachel, but Leah. And Jacob spends the night with her. And in the morning, lo and behold, it was Leah. Oh my goodness. So he says, "What have you done to me? Have I not worked for Rachel? Why have you deceived me?" And Laban gives probably the most sensible answer. "It is not done in our place to give the younger daughter before the elder daughter." And then he commands in verse 27. It's not a request. He says, "Fulfill the bridal week, the 7 days of the marriage week. Then I will give the other one to you, but for the another 7 years of work." And what is striking is verse 28. And there, Jacob had nothing to say, but all to do what Laban has asked him to do. Verse 28, Jacob did the same. He fulfilled the bridal week and Laban gave him Rachel as his wife, and you know, he went to Rachel and he loved. Finally, he got the love of his life and he worked for 7 more years because he loved Rachel more than Leah. What is striking is that the deceiver who once deceived his brother, who deceived his father, who pretended as Esau, is being deceived. The absence of speech in verse 28, to me it seems that Jacob realized, uh-oh, I am on the receiving end now. I deceived my father. You see, there are very good parallels between this story and the story that happened earlier. Earlier, a younger brother stole the birthright of an elder brother. And here, an elder sister is made steal the marriage opportunity of the younger sister. There, a son deceived the father. And here, a father deceives a son, son-in-law. Every action has its consequences. Laban's actions and words made Jacob realize that this time he is being deceived. And he has realized what he did was wrong. Everything that you do counts. I want us, the youngsters and everyone, be watchful what you do. Of course, we are surrounded by faith community. We are being molded, shaped. But know that every action that we do counts. No one's past actions will not go unattended. Galatians 6, 7 to 9 says, do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A person reaps what he or she sows. Friends, let's watch out all of our actions. And God brings many Labans in our lives. And it is more likely the reactions that we receive, it's more likely the reactions that we show. If somebody is angry at me, I have to double check my words and actions that may be hurtful. God brings into our lives many people to shape us, to show us who we are. And I was thinking, I'm the most gentle person in the world until I married to Margaret. And I came to know that I'm angry, possessive, and I may be selfish. Jacob had to learn his lesson. Laban's words and actions made Jacob realize that his past actions bear their consequences. People, be careful what you do. Do you know doing good things is also fun? Telling truth, doing good things are the most easiest things to do. Telling lies, on the other hand, is a difficult thing. You have to think smart. Doing bad things, you need a scheme, something big. Every action matters. Every choice we make matters. Every action that we do counts. Be watchful the decision you make and the work that you do, the things that you do. They all matter. But what prevails in the end is actually the divine directive. The divine directive is all that prevails. The purpose of God is in the end would prevail everything. Jacob, once deceiver, gets deceived. But God is on the roll, fulfilling his mission, fulfilling his word. You see, some of you might recognize the symmetrical structure of the Hebrew text. We call it chiasm. You don't need to worry about that word. It just means the crux of the story is put it in the middle and having similar parallels. Now, in this story, Laban deceives Jacob. But if you read the later portion of chapter 30, there, Jacob deceives Laban. He set some kind of mechanism so that his flocks would multiply. And he becomes wealthy at the cost of Laban. So here Laban deceives Jacob. There Jacob deceives Laban. But right in the middle, there is a wonderful story told. And And that is the birth of the children. Now you might question, okay, why should Jacob get married to two wives? Why should he get 12 children out of four women? This is not the time to argue. But that's exactly the point. In the midst of the human deceiving, in the midst of human societies that are not perfect, God works. He is on the roll. He fulfills his word. In the midst of human limitations, God fulfills his promises. No human action would deter God's purposes. You know, there were two prisoners sitting on an open area within the prison walls. And one person lowered his head and put his hand on his chin. And he was thinking about all that he was doing, all about his life. He was just mourning. He was vexing upon himself. But there was another prisoner who looked above and started counting stars. These two portrayals are important. For one, life is all about the things that happen around him. But for the other, there are things to look up. There are things to be concerned about. Proverbs 19:21 says, "Many are the plans in the mind of a man, but it is the purpose of the Lord that will stand." It is the purpose of the Lord that would prevail. There are things beyond our life under one roof. Rick Warren beautifully says, "You are made for God." There are bigger purposes in life. Now, studies are important. Exams are important. Please, write your exams well. Write your assignments well. Family needs, all are important. But life is made for a larger purpose. It's not about you. It's about God. It's about God's plans getting fulfilled. And your story, my story, are part of God's grand story. The writer of Ecclesiastes, he says, everything is fleeting away. Everything is maya. It's like a vapor. But what stands still is fearing God and obeying God's commandments. God can choose anyone. He can choose the younger, the elder. In ancient Near Eastern setting, the firstborn is the default chosen. But God says, I can even break that law of primogeniture. I'm not confined to the world system. I can choose anyone. It can be a deceiver. It can be a person with a limitation. It can be anyone. But I can choose that person and work my will and purposes through that person. God is sovereign. It is all about God's sovereignty, my dear brothers and sisters. Your story and my story are part of that God story. In the end, his plan and purposes would prevail for the liberation of the fallen world. Every choice that you make counts. Watch out your choices. And I like Richard Lewis saying, we make choices, God guides our steps. But you should know, you should be conscious about the choices that you make. It's very important. But God is gracious by bestowing his wisdom to choose good and bad. And Deuteronomy 31, God says, I will give you the heart of circumcision. I will circumcise your hearts so that you will choose to repent. Everything that we do matters. Everything has its consequences. If not now, surely later. Watch out what we do. You are at the prime of your life. And know to do good and learn to do good and know the consequences. And in the end, God's purposes would prevail. God is on the roll. His grand purpose for the nation is so vividly told in the scriptures. That's why Christopher Wright, he calls it missional hermeneutic of the scripture. You read the scripture, every page you turn, it's all about the grand narrative of God's mission and unveiling grand purposes of God for the nations. It's all about God's purposes getting fulfilled. And praise the Lord that our story is part of His story. Jesus prioritized doing God's will. He made choice. He left the heavenly abode, came down, emptied Himself. The best choice that He made. He chose to submit to God's will. All His actions were full of compassion. He saw the people suffering. He met all their needs. And at the end, He surrendered to the Father's will. He knew in the end, the Father's will be fulfilled. Friends, let us ask God's wisdom to make good decisions in our lives. Let us value people and have compassion on them. Let us have Jesus' eyes towards the people. Let us surrender ourselves to God's will and purpose. May the Lord help us understand that His purpose in the end would be fulfilled. Shall we pray? Father, You have embraced us as we are. You have given us Your only Son, Jesus Christ, as our Savior. You have loved us first. Help us, Lord, to believe in Your divine guidance in our daily lives. Give us wisdom to make choices in life and do things without selfish motives. Help us to have the big picture of Your grand purpose for the restoration of Your creation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.